Good morning. Today, Pastor Peter Chin will share the message from the book of Matthew, chapter 6, verses 9 through 13. I will read in Cantonese, and Allison will read in English. You can follow along on page 662 in the Pew Bibles in front of you or on the screens above. Here's the word of the Lord.
你们应当这样祷告：我们天上的父，愿人都尊崇你的圣名。This,
then, is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name.
愿你的国度降临，愿你的旨意在地上成就，就像在天上成就一样。Your
kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
求你今天赐给我们日用的饮食。Give
us today our daily bread.
饶恕我们的罪，就像我们饶恕了得罪我们的人。And
forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors.
不要让我们遇见诱惑，救我们脱离那恶者，因为国度、权柄、荣耀都是你的，直到永远。 Amen.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. This is the word of the Lord.
All right, good morning, everyone. I wanted to start off with just to follow up a little bit to the announcement previously about the children's ministry. First off, free coffee, a punch card, that's pretty priceless if you ask me. Well, it's got a price, but it's nice. The other thing I would say is, you know, we are committed to helping our kids. I think what compels me the most is just to think about your own story and to think about for how many of us our childhood is a part of our spiritual journey, right? For some of us, maybe not. Maybe some of our childhoods was very separate from where we ended up. But for, I'd say, a lot of us, are where we ended up following after Jesus, a part of that story, a part of how we understand and follow after Christ was developed in childhood. And so when I think about children's ministry, I don't think about childcare. I think that's like the flattest way we can think about this. But ultimately, when you think about it in the way I just described, really children's ministry is discipleship, that we're adding into part of the story by which young people understand God. That's discipleship. It's part of how they form their approach to God and what it means to be a follower after Jesus. And so I think that's a much more hefty term for children's ministry, right? This is not babysitting. In the same way that when people cared for us, when we were young, developing us was not babysitting. It was discipleship. And so I hope that as you think about signing up, yes, free coffee, but in addition, discipleship. That just in the same way someone poured into your life, it wasn't any easier 40, 30 years ago. It wasn't like people were less tired or they worked less or they, you know, had more time on Sundays. There were 26 hours on Sunday. No, it was just as hard, but they still took time out to do that in each of our lives, many of our lives. And so I hope that we'll see it from that perspective, continuing on what God has done. With that, I do want to transition into our Sunday sermon, which is really about the Lord's Prayer. We've been going through this for the past few weeks, and we are now on the home stretch. We're on the last third of the Lord's Prayer, and what we've discovered about the Lord's Prayer so far is that there are many terms and words in the Lord's Prayer that don't mean what we think they mean, that we've had to kind of reapproach them and re-understand them in order to really get at the heart of what's being communicated. And last week was a really great example of that. Last week, we went over that line where it says, give us today our daily bread. Give us today our daily bread. Well known, we all pray that prayer. What's really interesting about that prayer is when we pray daily bread, we more often than not think about a calendar. We think about Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, that kind of bread. Right? That's kind of, we think about chronological kind of concerns. But what's really interesting is that in the Greek, the word that's used for daily there has nothing to do with time whatsoever. It's not the Greek word for every single day. Instead, it's this very interesting word in the Greek that's nearly untranslatable, has nothing to do with the calendar, and it's the word epiousios. And epiousios means literally super necessary, super essential. And what it points to is that we need things even more than bread. We need the bread of life. We need the word. There are spiritual hungers that we have. And it's a reminder to us not to overlook those spiritual hungers. Not just a chase after the physical things that we need. God knows that we need them, and he's a good provider, but we still have spiritual needs that we have to pay attention to. And that's a very different understanding of that line in the Lord's Prayer than oftentimes we think. This understanding of give us today this super essential bread, this super necessary bread. Today, we're going to move forward into the next line, which is forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Now, you might be asking, as we've discovered so far, is there some trick to this? Is there some maybe different word in Greek that we don't know that completely transforms our understanding of this phrase that we can, you know, totally know it anew? And the answer is no. There's nothing really complex about this. There's no hidden Greek. There's nothing really fancy about it. What you see with this verse is really what you get. It's a command to forgive other people in the same way that we've been forgiven. That's just it. There's really no fancy thing here. It's a very simple and very straightforward teaching about forgiveness in this situation. But while it might be perhaps the most straightforward and easiest part of the Lord's Prayer to understand, I think that many of us would acknowledge that forgiving others is one of the single hardest things that we are commanded to do as Christians. This might be a very simple thing that we're reading here, but that doesn't make it easy to do. And I think for many of us, and when I pray the Lord's Prayer, this is the part that always trips me up. Everything else can kind of just flow off the tongue, right? Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as heaven. Give us day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Because then that really challenges us, and it forces us to think, do I actually do that? Have I actually forgiven other people for what they've done wrong? And if I haven't, what does that mean about me? For me, this is the one line of the Lord's Prayer that has the most personal and direct impact in my life, because I really have to ask the question as to whether I'm really forgiving other people. And very often, the answer is no. I think for many of us, it's a struggle to really do this. This is a very simple command, but we all know it's not simple to do, that it's extremely difficult, if anything. So what does the Lord's Prayer do for us? How can it help us understand forgiveness, maybe approach it in a way that makes it more possible for us to forgive those around us? Well, I think the main thing that I want us to recognize that in the Lord's Prayer, the way that the Lord's Prayer defines or characterizes forgiveness is not really as one single action, but really as two connected ones instead. Because when you look at the Lord's Prayer, it has not just one part where it says, you should forgive people, then talks about something else. It has two parts. And the two parts are being forgiven, right? That we have to be forgiven by God. And the second part of forgiveness, as defined by the Lord's Prayer, is then forgiving other people. So when the Lord's Prayer looks at this idea of forgiveness, what's interesting is that it doesn't really treat it or see it as one single action that we do, but instead it connects two things into one, right? Two sides of one coin. That this is the idea of being forgiven by God, but also forgiving others, and you put those two things together, that's what forgiveness ultimately is. It's two interconnected ideas instead of just one single practice or one thing that we have to do. What's really interesting is that this connection, this definition of forgiveness being this connection between different kinds of forgivenesses, is actually not just what we see in the Lord's Prayer, it's what you'll see all throughout the New Testament. In the New Testament, when it talks and defines forgiveness, very rarely does it talk about one thing at a time. But instead, what you'll find over and over and over, as we'll see, is that forgiveness is always tied to forgiveness. And the way that the Bible approaches forgiveness is that it always connects these two things, whether in one direction or the other. So it really treats it as these connected ideas rather than separated ones that never touch one another. There's one connection. The first connection that we see between forgiveness and forgiveness is that it is God's forgiveness of us that makes forgiveness of others possible or even logical. This idea that when we receive God's forgiveness, that's what makes forgiveness of other people logical, right? It's forgiveness leading to forgiveness, and we see that several times in the New Testament. For example, in the story of the woman who anoints Jesus in Luke chapter 7. Many of us know that story where there's this woman who pours out a year's salary worth of perfume on Jesus' head and upon his feet. And then the disciples are shocked by this, and they question, how is she able to do such a thing? And Jesus responds, and this is the Message translation of the Bible. He explains her motivation by saying this. Impressive, isn't it, what she's done? She was forgiven many, many sins, and so she is very, very grateful. For in Jesus' eyes, the motivation, the reason why she's able to do this incredible act of sacrifice is forgiveness. Forgiveness is what motivated her to do more. We read the same thing in Ephesians chapter 4, where Paul writes, "Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other." He could have just ended that right there, and that would have been a perfectly fine biblical command. Forgive each other, period. But he doesn't. He connects our forgiveness to one another to this other phrase where he says, "Just as in Christ God forgave you." He doesn't define forgiveness simply as forgiving other people. He connects it to the forgiveness we have received from God. He'll say the exact same thing in Colossians chapter 3, verse 13. "Forgive as the Lord God forgave you." Those two forgivenesses being connected. Maybe the most famous example of this is the parable of the unmerciful servant, where Jesus is teaching about forgiveness, and he doesn't just tell people, forgive people. You should do it out of your own strength, out of your own goodwill, forgive people. Instead, he tells a story about a servant who owns his master, who owes his master hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of debt. But he can't pay it back, and so the master has mercy upon him and just absolves him of it. Doesn't give him a payment plan, just says, it's gone. You don't have to pay me whatsoever. But then that same servant turns around and he finds a servant who owes him a few dollars and begins to beat him and choke him in order to get back what he thinks he deserves. And when we break into the passage, it says this, "When the other servants saw what had happened, they were outraged and went and told their master everything that had happened. Then the master called the servant in. 'You wicked servant,' he said, 'I canceled all that debt of yours because you begged me to. Shouldn't you have had mercy on your fellow servant just as I had on you?'" When Jesus commands us to forgiveness, it's not just this raw act of obedience. He doesn't just say, "Forgive because I command you to do it." He always points back to the forgiveness we've already received. Forgive the dollars because you've been forgiven the fortune instead. Forgiveness is connected to one another. Our forgiveness of other people is motivated and even logical in light of the forgiveness that we have received from God. And that teaches us something about forgiveness. Just this one connection that God's forgiveness flows into forgiveness of other people really brings about the question for us that, you know, for many of us, forgiveness is very difficult, if not maybe impossible. Maybe there's one personal situation where forgiveness for everything that you've seen is just not a possibility. But when we realize this connection, what this naturally brings to our mind is this, that maybe the reason that you can't forgive that person or that situation in your life is because you don't truly feel forgiven yourself. It's because you haven't really acknowledged and you really haven't sat in the fact that God has taken away all of your sin. And you still live with a lot of guilt and shame motivating you. And because you don't really feel or remember the forgiveness that Christ has poured out into your life, all you have to give to someone is what's in your heart, which is that shame, which is that guilt. And that's the reason why you can't forgive, is because you haven't been forgiven, because you don't know that forgiveness in your own life. And that's very different from our usual motivation, because we think, what's wrong with me? Why am I not forgiving? Why can I let this go? Maybe the answer is very strange. It's maybe because you haven't accepted forgiveness for yourself. That in some way you minimized what Jesus has done. You think that your sins are bigger than Jesus and the cross. Don't do that. Your sins are not bigger than what Jesus has done. And so this connection between forgivenesses then begins to help us to think about why we don't forgive and why we should forgive in a very different light. The second connection between forgivenesses is this, that forgiving others actually invites even more of God's forgiveness into our lives. So not only does God's forgiveness cause us to forgive other people, but when we forgive other people, it actually allows us to experience more of God's forgiveness. And we see this in the Lord's Prayer. In the Lord's Prayer, we often very conveniently cut it off at verse 13. Verse 13 says, don't lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil, period. And we think that's the end of Jesus' teaching on the Lord's Prayer, but that's not the end. If you keep on going, it says this, "For if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. Little wonder we don't like to keep on reading in that passage. But I do want to explain this a little bit, that the forgiveness that Jesus is talking about here is not the forgiveness we receive from the cross, from the blood of Jesus Christ. We don't earn that in any single way. There is nothing that we can do to make that possible or to receive it. There is no good work that makes this something that we deserve ultimately. Even forgiveness. This salvific forgiveness, this salvific grace is something that we receive simply by faith. That's not what Jesus is talking about when he talks about forgiveness. He's talking about the forgiveness we receive all throughout the days of our lives that fills in the cracks of our lives for the daily sins that we commit, this grace and this freedom that we feel on a daily basis through grace. That kind of forgiveness actually is conditional. Not the grace that we get from Jesus on the cross. We can't do anything to earn that ultimately. But daily forgiveness, yes. It is something that when we forgive other people, we experience more richness, more of God's forgiveness in all the corners of our lives. And in the same way, when we refuse to forgive other people, we're turning off that tap. The forgiveness that God wants to pour into our lives runs dry if we don't forgive other people. He'll say this again in Mark chapter 11. When you stand praying, if you hold anything against anyone, forgive them so that your Father in heaven may forgive you your sins. When we forgive other people, more of God's forgiveness flows into our life. Forgiveness begets more forgiveness. That when we forgive people, we experience more of God's forgiveness in turn. And you see that this also begins to change our understanding of forgiveness. That, like I said earlier, some of us really struggle with forgiveness. We don't really feel forgiven. We still live with a lot of guilt and a lot of shame. We struggle to break free of it. And when we think about this connection between forgiveness and forgiveness, maybe one of the reasons that we don't fully feel forgiven is because we're not forgiving other people. Because we refuse to forgive other people, we're not experiencing the full measure of God's forgiveness that he wants to pour out into our lives, because we're turning off that tap with our own lack of forgiveness. And so again, this connection teaches us different things about forgiveness and where it comes from and how do we experience more of it throughout our lives. What I'm trying to show to us is that the Lord's Prayer in the New Testament has a radically different perception of what forgiveness looks like. That for many of us, we see it as a single action, isolated actions, right? That I need to receive God's forgiveness, or else I need to forgive this person who has wronged me. And we separate those two actions from one another as these single titanic acts that we need to receive or else do. The Scripture doesn't do that. Your Scripture connects those things into one concept, which is the concept of forgiveness. Receiving God's grace will always pour out into people's lives. It's a flow, it's a river that goes one place to the other. As we forgive other people, we experience even deeper measures of God's forgiveness. That is how the Bible conceives of forgiveness, not as one single thing, receiving grace or giving grace, but instead grace that goes into grace. Grace we pour out into grace so we receive it again. It shows it as a river or as a flow or as a rhythm, which is a very different mental perception of what forgiveness truly is. Not just this burden where we think, I've got to forgive this person, it's going to be so hard, but instead as a rhythm of receiving God's grace so it flows out to somebody and forgiving someone so we can receive more of it in turn. It's this cycle, this circle, this river, this rhythm, which is forgiveness, not this one incredibly difficult act that we're called to do. I've talked about this earlier, but this is one of those moments where it would really be awesome if we all spoke German, because the German language has this unique idea where you can make a compound verb out of anything, a compound noun out of anything. You just smash all the words together to create one idea, which is why theologians love German, and a lot of great theology is written in German. And this is one of those things where it would be great if we sandwiched these two understandings of forgiveness into one understanding. If we had a word that could just describe these two halves of what forgiveness really are. Because right now we separate them into different sides of the room. We have God has forgiven me, grace that God pours out. And then completely separate in a different part of our lives, different situations, we say, I got to forgive other people. We have to realize we should sandwich them together. These words should flow one after the other. If we spoke German, it would be something like, God has forgiven me, so I should forgive others. That's the way we should talk about forgiveness. That's what the Bible says about forgiveness. That's what the Lord's Prayer says about forgiveness. Or vice versa, as I forgive others, I should be more of God's forgiveness. Right? And Germans do this all the time. They'll sandwich 63 letters in a row. The world record for the longest single word in the world goes to Germans. And it's because they take these ideas that seem separate, but they're actually one and the same. And that's what forgiveness truly is. And I want us to begin to challenge our understanding of forgiveness. Not to see it as separate things, but instead as ideas that are really tied together. There are some real benefits to doing this. That if we change our understanding of forgiveness to be this flow and this rhythm of one thing going to the other and doing it and then flowing it back into our lives, three things that I would point out. The first thing is that it connects forgiveness to a bigger story and provides much deeper motivation. When we think about forgiveness as isolated things, we are actually cutting off a story short of its full progression. When we just say, God, you have forgiven me, thank you, Jesus, but we cut it off right there, we are not allowing that ocean to flow into something else. You know what I mean? We're just saying, God, this ocean of forgiveness I have, I'm just going to build a dam around it. That's it. This is grace. That's all that it is. We're not allowing it to do what it's supposed to be doing, which is to flow into another person's life, that they might get a trickle of that ocean as well. We're closing the book as if we're on chapter 2. Wow, this is great. Bam, that's it. I'm done with this book. There are several chapters afterwards that come out of forgiveness that should affect the people around us. In the same way, if we just talk about forgiving other people, we're not going to the Genesis. We're cutting ourselves from the ocean. We're just saying, I've got to do this incredibly difficult thing that maybe someone has traumatized me, abused me in some very profound way, and I'm just supposed to forgive this person out of the goodness of my own heart, and God says, no, you're not. I never commanded you to forgive out of the goodness of your heart. I commanded you to forgive out of the goodness of my heart. Chapter 1 and chapter 2 is what's supposed to give you the motivation and the power to forgive other people. If we disconnect ourselves from the earlier part of the story, we're disconnecting ourselves from the power of forgiveness, from the genesis of forgiveness. So you see why we have to have this rhythm. Because if we break off this rhythm, we're closing the book. We're closing this book far too early. We're skipping over the earlier chapters and just going to the end. This is one of the most powerful reasons why we need this different understanding of forgiveness. Secondly, it allows us to forgive in small ways and on a daily basis instead of just once in a while. I think oftentimes our understanding of forgiveness is that it just revolves around the big things. God's grace poured out upon the cross, and then these big hurts that we have received throughout our entire lives. That's where forgiveness takes place. And it's definitely true. It's definitely true that those are huge moments of forgiveness. But let's be honest with ourselves. Aren't there many more moments throughout our lives where we need to forgive people? Are the only moments that you have to forgive someone when they really hurt you in some big way? What about when you're driving? Let's just focus on that one part of our lives. Don't we need to have more forgiveness there? What about in families? Even when your family is not like punching you in the face, there are 100 little jabs that they do in the meantime that we also need to forgive. Coworkers, it doesn't really matter. We have to recognize that forgiveness, the real application points of forgiveness are not once every 10 years. They're once every 5 minutes when you really think about it. But this big, titanic understanding of forgiveness only applies to once every 10 years. And so in our mental space, we're thinking, I'm prepared to forgive this one person for the next 9 years. I'm not going to forgive anybody. I'm just out of practice. I don't have to do that. When we see forgiveness as a rhythm instead, it prepares us to see forgiveness as a daily kind of practice. Can you imagine that? Forgiveness as a daily practice. Not just as a once in a lifetime, twice in a lifetime, but that every single day, your life, your day would be filled with an infilling of God's forgiveness. That you would receive God's forgiveness afresh, and that someone would receive it on that day. Not just once a year, not just once every 5 years, but that forgiveness would mark you on a daily level, which is so much better. So much better. Lastly, Forgiveness as this rhythm prepares us for forgiveness, not just for the past, but for the future. The other shortfall of seeing forgiveness as this big thing is that it almost always applies to the past, right? God's forgiveness on the cross, that's way in the past. And then forgiving someone who has hurt me in the past. Forgiveness is always something where we always look back into our lives and we try to apply it to prior situations. But what that does then is that we are woefully unprepared for the future moments where we need to forgive someone. And if you were prepared to forgive someone, wouldn't it make it that much easier? If you really felt like you were ready to forgive someone. That's what the rhythm of forgiveness does, because it connects the past to the future. It tells us God has forgiven me, so I will forgive other people. It connects this longer chronology, right? It's not just in the past now. Now God's forgiveness has a translation in the future, as an application point in days to come. I have forgiven someone in my past, so I will receive more of God's forgiveness in the future. Forgiveness becomes a past, present, and a future reality instead of just one that always remains in our past instead. You know, I remember a story that my wife told me about. She messed up at work, and she had to come clean to her boss. And so, she had done something wrong and told her boss, and her boss gave her immediate forgiveness. Immediate forgiveness. She didn't even think twice. She just said, well, that's what forgiveness is for. And that was it. She never brought it up again. And the reason we recognize that she did this is because she was ready to forgive. She was ready to forgive. She went into her day ready to forgive someone. Do many of us do that? I know I don't. Our preparation for the day usually doesn't include that, but for her it did, because forgiveness was a future thing. It wasn't just in the past that I had to forgive other people in my past. She was ready. If you dropped that dime, she would pick it up and say, here's your dime back, because I'm ready to forgive you. How much easier would forgiveness be if it wasn't just a past dynamic, but it was something that we were prepared to do every single morning when we got up? You see now the power of rhythm, the power of transforming our paradigm of forgiveness to being these big things that are just huge once in our lifetime to a daily rhythm instead. What I want us to do is I want us to actually practice that and express that today in something called breath prayer. Breath prayer, if you don't know it, is a way of praying using our physical breath. That we use our physical breath as a way to structure and to focus our prayer. Now, that might sound very New Agey, very yoga-ish, but actually, breath prayer is a very ancient Christian tradition. We think popcorn prayer is Christian. Breath prayer is much older than popcorn prayer, trust me. Right? It was used by monks and monasteries, you know, over the course of 1,000 years. And it's also this really cool way to fulfill an impossible command in 1 Thessalonians 5, which is pray without ceasing. Anyone know that command? How many of us do that well? Go ahead and raise your hand so God can see you. I'm not going to raise my hand because it's really hard. There is one other thing that we do in our life without ceasing, which is breathing. Breathing is probably the only other thing that we kind of physically notice that we do without ceasing. If we could pray with our breath, we can pray without ceasing. It also is a great way to pray while also being mindful about where we are. You see, when we do popcorn-style prayer, which is my bread-and-butter prayer, if you don't know what that is, I'll tell you later. You always have to, you got to talk all the time. You got to think about, what am I going to pray about? This is the right way to pray it. And you use a good part of your mental energy thinking about what you're going to say. With breath prayer, you pray a very simple thing so you can pay attention to what you really feel, what's really going on in your heart. And so I love that it gives me the space to do that. Finally, we have to recognize this is a very biblical idea. Breath is this repeated theme throughout Scripture. Breath is how God breathes life into things. Adam, he gets the breath of God in his nostrils. When we talk about the valley of dry bones, how does it come to life? But by God's breath. The name of the Holy Spirit, both in the Old Testament, Ruah, but in the New Testament, Pneuma, both mean breath. Worship is associated with breath. Let everything that has breath worship, praise the Lord, right? Breath is this fundamental way in which we connect with God, because it's God who gave us that breath. And it's also a way that we can explore forgiveness as well. What I'm going to ask us to do is this. We're going to practice breath prayer together. And what we're going to do is we're going to breathe in and then breathe out. And with each breath, we're going to pray a different thing. So we're going to breathe deeply in as in filling your belly with air. Many of us don't do that. We breathe from our chest as if this is what's happening, but really our diaphragm is expanding downwards. So we should really be filling our belly with air. So you're going to breathe in, and as you breathe in, you're going to say, I am fully forgiven by God. And I want you to know that's true, that your sins are not bigger than the cross, and what you've done wrong is not more powerful than the blood of Jesus. I want you to just breathe that in and breathe life into your soul. And as you breathe out, as you will have to breathe out, I want you to pray this, and I will forgive those around me. Breathing out forgiveness, right? And in this way, breath begins to mirror what forgiveness truly is. Forgiveness is, it's not, and holding your breath for the rest of your life. Neither is just, and that's it. It's this constant dynamic of breathing in grace and breathing it out, breathing in forgiveness that it might go out to other people. That's what forgiveness truly is. And as you do that, you don't need to make up any words. You don't have to say, Father God, I just pray right now that you would forgive me and that you would help me do all the stuff. Don't do any of that today. Just pray those simple prayers so you can pay attention to what's going on in your heart and going on in your mind. What's hard about this? What names come into your mind? Why do you feel a certain way instead? So we're just going to do this for a few moments as the worship team comes up. Let's just close our eyes for a moment. I'm going to guide us for the first few breaths, but then just do it by yourself. And again, let's all breathe deeply in, just filling our lungs with air. And as we do that, pray silently to yourself, I am forgiven fully by Christ. And as you breathe out these words, and I forgive those around me. Again, I am fully forgiven by Christ. And I forgive those around me. One more time. I am fully forgiven by Christ, and I forgive those around me. Just do that on your own. Just breathe in the grace that comes with Jesus. Breathe out the forgiveness that we are commanded to give. And let's just do that as a prayer unto God, and then I'll close this in prayer. But let's pray using our breath for a short while. Lord Jesus, thank you for your forgiveness. Your forgiveness is why we are here. We are here not just because you taught us, not because you demonstrated something, but because we are forgiven. Thank you for that. Help us, Lord, not to simply define forgiveness as that one action. Help us to do what you commanded, that forgiveness might result in forgiveness. Forgiveness to those who are around us. And as we obey that command to forgive others, that then we would even experience more of that wellspring of forgiveness you pour out. In our minds, in our hearts, help us to imagine forgiveness in a radically different way. No longer as these single things that we are commanded to receive and do, but instead as this blessed cycle, as a river that flows one from the other, an ocean to an ocean. Thank you, Lord. Transform us and help us this week to give forgiveness and to receive forgiveness just a little more than we did before. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.